just anybody would do this.
Pretty special that way. Lord, we thank you for Dave, and we just ask, Lord, that you will give him the words to say to us, the wisdom and the boldness to say, and that he may speak it with clarity. And Lord, give us hearts and ears to listen and to take it to heart and to obey you when it's tough and when we feel uncomfortable. Lord, just work in our lives today through the message, and we give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Good to be back with you this morning. We're going to be in John 18 today, John chapter 18, part of the trial of Christ before Pilate. We're going to be talking about truth. Story is told about a guy that was in seminary, and he was back from school. He went to a worship service one Sunday at a church he hadn't been to, and the pastor's topic was all religious beliefs are true. All religious beliefs are true. After the service, the seminary student tried to avoid the pastor, but you know how it is. The pastor was standing there shaking hands. And so the pastor started up a conversation with a young man as he was shaking his hand. And he says, "Well, young man, what are your religious beliefs?" And the guy says, "Well, sir, I'd just soon not share them with you." And the pastor says, "Well, why not?" He says, "I won't be offended. I mean, all religious beliefs are true." And so the seminarian leans over and whispers in the pastor's ear, and he says, "Sir, I think you're going to hell." And the pastor turned a little red, and he said, "Well, I guess I made a mistake this morning." He says, "I guess all religious beliefs aren't true because I don't believe yours," he said. That's what we're talking about this morning, is truth and what it means. What it means. You can go ahead with the first PowerPoint. This is a scene from the trial of Christ when he's before Pontius Pilate. And Jesus talks about his kingdom and being a kingdom of truth. We are in chapter 18. We're going to begin reading at verse 28. I'll read it and then we'll kind of work through it. I read from the NIV Bible. "Then the Jews led Jesus from Caiaphas to the place of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanliness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and he asked, 'What charges are you bringing against this man?' 'If he were not a criminal,' they replied, 'we would not have handed him over to you.' Pilate said, 'Take him yourselves, judge him by your own law.' 'But we have no right to execute anyone,' the Jews objected. And this happened so that the words that Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he was going to die, would be fulfilled. Pilate then went back inside the palace. He summoned Jesus and he asked him, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' 'Is that your own idea?' Jesus asked, 'or did others talk to you about me?' 'Am I a Jew?' Pilate replied. 'It was your own people and your own chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you've done?' Jesus said, 'My kingdom's not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But my kingdom's from another place.' 'You are a king then,' said Pilate. And Jesus answered, 'You're right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this reason I came into the world, to testify to the truth. And everyone on the side of truth listens to me.' 'What is truth?' Pilate asked. And with this he went out again to the Jews, and he said, 'I find no basis for a charge against him.'" Jesus before Pilate. In verse 28 it says Jesus was taken from the... He was before Caiaphas, of course, the high priest. After they was done there, he took him to the Roman governor. And, of course, the whole process, as we know, was a little frahoodled, as my wife would say. It's an Amish term. they went to the palace of Pilate. And Pilate came outside to speak to the Jews because this was the Passover time. and the Jews didn't want to go in any building that had leaven or yeast in it, okay? And so Pilate came out of respect to them. He came outside so the Jews didn't have to come inside. Pilate asked about the charges, of course, and the Jewish folks didn't answer right away. They said, listen, if he wasn't a criminal, we wouldn't have brought him to you, okay? We would not have brought him here. Pilate in verse 31 says, take him yourselves. This is kind of a little bit of sarcasm. Take him yourselves, judging by your law. You know, it's kind of this idea that I'm up here, and you're down here, and you have your law, and you have your rules, and you just take care of it yourself, and don't bother me with it. I was thinking about this morning. I wonder if the relationship wasn't a little bit like it is on the Indian reservations in our country, where, you know, they can have their own police force and certain things like that, but yet they're still under the United States government. You know what I mean? There's only certain things they can do. It might be a little bit like that, but at any rate, the Jews could do certain things, but they couldn't execute. And that's what it says in verse 31. We have no right to execute anyone. The Jewish people wanted Jesus dead. They wanted him dead. They couldn't do it because the Romans wouldn't let him. And so that's why they brought him to Pilate. That's the only reason they brought him. So Pilate goes back inside in verse 33 and he talks to Jesus. He says, are you the king? Are you the king of the Jews? And Jesus tries to get Pilate into some conversation here. And Jesus wants to know, is this just Pilate asking him some questions because of the legal beagle part of it? You know what I mean? Or is Pilate really interested in who Jesus is? And Pilate might have an interest because of what Pilate's wife had spoken to him. You find that in Matthew. And you know, if your wife has an interest in something, guys, you're going to hear about it at home, so you might want to check it out, right? You might want to check it out. And so whether they talked about this before this point, or if it just happened now that his wife had mentioned it, could be that Pilate has an interest now, more than just as judge, that he might have an interest. And Jesus is the type of person that can take these conversations and make them into spiritual conversations, think the woman at the well. Okay? And so this is what Jesus is about. And so Jesus is drawing Pilate into a conversation. Jesus not being rude when he says, that's your own idea, you know. But Pilate says, listen, I'm not a Jew. I don't care. I don't care. Okay? I do not care. The Jewish people were not looked upon highly, okay? Pilate didn't like being where he was, okay? This wasn't the highest, this wasn't the best promotion in the Roman government to be in this place, okay? Pilate didn't care for it. Pilate says, I don't care. Am I a Jew? He says, your people brought you here. I don't care. And Jesus says, my kingdom's not of this world, else we would fight. And that's obvious. If the president, if somebody tried to take the president, there'd be all kinds of people fighting, wouldn't there? And even Osama bin Laden, who didn't have a kingdom to speak of, no political boundaries, but he sure surrounded himself with people who protect him. You know what I mean? And that's kind of where Jesus is at, but Jesus is not. Nobody's protecting him. As a matter of fact, this is always struck me as very interesting, this passage. That Jesus would say, "This my kingdom's not this world. We're not going to fight." It helps me to prioritize things a little bit, to be reminded that this world and the political system, like we talked about in Sunday school, this isn't as good as it gets. Okay? And Jesus is saying, Pilate, my kingdom's not of this world. If it was, you know how people protect their kingdoms, okay? I'm not doing that, okay? My kingdom's of another place. So you are a king, Pilate says. And Jesus says, well, you know, you're right. You're right, I'm a king. And in fact, for this reason I was born, it was for this mission that I came into the world. I came into the world to testify to the truth. To testify to truth, so people would know what truth is. And my kingdom is a kingdom of truth. And Jesus, or Pilate says, sarcastically almost, what is truth? You can go ahead to the next PowerPoint. What is truth? Pilate asked a question that you could take a philosophy class, I suspect, in most any country in the world, at most any time in the world. And they would argue, what is truth? What is truth? I find it interesting that when Jesus was before Pilate, he wasn't begging for mercy. He wasn't begging for justice. He wasn't saying, listen, I've been falsely accused. If I would have been there, I would have been really concerned about fairness issues. You know? And justice. But that's not where Jesus was. Jesus was before Pilate, and his concern was that Pilate knew about truth. And Pilate didn't get it. Just like so many people throughout the years have not gotten it. Well, I've always found this passage very helpful. It helps me to kind of solidify what's important, to prioritize things. I think it's just natural that if we've been arrested falsely and accused falsely, that we would want some justice. And we would want some fairness. And that's not even part of where Jesus is at right here. And it's interesting because there were times in Jesus' life that he slipped away from crowds. This isn't the first time people wanted him dead, is it? And he was able to slip away from crowds and protect his life and save his life. But at this point in his life, he's staying there and he's taking it. And this is one reason we know Jesus was in charge of all the events, okay? Jesus always knew what was going on. Jesus was able to slip away when it wasn't his time, but now it's his time. Now it's his time, and God is in control. And Jesus is in control. And Jesus is not too excited about the fairness things, and he's not too excited about the justice issues. Because for this reason, he came to earth. He was born to bring truth, first to the Jews, and then to the Gentiles. And the truth is, it's only through Jesus that we can have a relationship with God. Truth is hard for people in our society to hear. And so it's helpful for me to look back on this passage and see that Jesus dealt with the same issues that we deal with today. Truth was hard for Pilate to hear. Very hard. What is truth, he says? And it's this idea that, I don't know what truth is, but this guy sitting in front of me, Jesus, he can't know anything about it any more than anybody else. What is truth? Well, truth can be offensive. Who likes to have somebody tell them that their breath stinks? Or your fly is open. Or that casserole you brought to the potluck tastes like burnt engine oil or something. You know, who likes to know? Who wants to hear truth? Well, the truth of the matter is, we do want to hear those things. You know, I tell my wife to look me over before I come up, just so I try not to embarrass myself, you know. But, so we want to know, but what types of people bring that to our attention? Well, the motivation is terribly important, isn't it? If it's out of love and concern for us, well, that's helpful. I want to know if my breath stinks, okay? But, so there's two people that do it. Either it's people who are trying to be helpful or people who are mean, right? And the motivation can often get misinterpreted. Would you agree with that? But that's another topic. But the point is, truth can be offensive. And so those who speak truth can be offensive as well, can't they? And it's the same way when we speak about the gospel, we speak the truth of Christ. It can be offensive. It's a challenge. And part of it's the way we speak it. We can be mean, we can be damning, we can be I'm up here, you're down here type of thing. Well, people aren't going to be able to hear that too well, are they? That's not a very good motivation. But if we're sincerely interested in people and sincerely interested in their souls, that truth needs to be heard, but it still is going to be offensive. It can still be offensive, okay? That's why trusted friends are the best evangelists, because they're going to be able to hear you best, and they're going to know your motivation the best. And so trusted friends are the best evangelists. Well, but there's always going to be Pontius Pilate who figure there's no truth, at least not of the eternal sort. And there are different ways, there are different reasons people struggle with truth. One is that if we say that we have the truth, and some people are going to say we're narrow-minded, right? We're narrow-minded. Well, truth by nature is narrow, okay? Truth by nature is a narrow path. 2 + 2 is... Well, I'm impressed. 2 + 2 is 4, okay? If it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it'd be a wide path, but 2 + 2 is 4. And anything else is wrong. It's just wrong. That's narrow. But it's also truth. Truth, for some people, can be arrogant. People who claim to know what's right can come across arrogant. If I say I have truth, and somebody else disagrees with that, then that's going to come across as arrogant to them. But is it arrogant for the math teacher to insist that 2 + 2 is 4? Is it arrogant if I go place my hand on a Bible in a court of law and say, I swear to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God, and then I get up on the stand and tell the truth? Am I being arrogant? That's not arrogant. This might be a good place to say that truth, sometimes we get ourselves in trouble with truth, and we forget that truth can be added to. We can add to it. Let me give you an example. If I'm the plaintiff's attorney in a case, I'm going to have a bunch of witnesses, aren't I? And so let's say this person robs a store. So I bring one person up, and they testify that this person who robbed the store was a male. But they didn't really see anything else, but they just know he was a guy. Okay. They get down, the next person goes up and says, you know what, it was a guy, and he had a red hat. Well, that kind of adds to the truth, doesn't it? It doesn't make the first one wrong, it adds to it. And the next person comes up and says, it was a guy, he had a red hat, and he had facial hair. So he was very handsome. But that adds to the truth, doesn't it? Okay, it adds to the truth. Now the defense might go at it differently. They might bring somebody up and they say, did you see what happened? Yes. I seen a woman with a green hat, hopefully with no facial hair. Okay? Well, in one case we're adding to the truth, but obviously they're both not true, right? Okay? They're both not true. It's the same way in faith, the same way with our Sunday schools, and as we learn, we start out with the truth we know about Christ, and through the years we kind of add to it, don't we? And it grows richer, and we get a better idea of the full truth. But we have to be careful, because sometimes... This is what Chuck Swindoll used to say about Sunday school classes. If there's nobody that kind of brings it back to truth, it can be a problem. Because just because somebody speaks in church doesn't make it truth. Right? Doesn't make it truth. Doesn't make them bad, but doesn't make them truth. And so that's why leadership is so important, that is you need to have people kind of can help bring it back to truth. Otherwise, we leave people with the wrong impression. You know what I mean? So I want to say a little bit about truth that kind of grows. Okay, we build on it. Okay. Some people think you're arrogant. Some people say truth. That just excludes people. And we want to be inclusive. And we want everybody to be part. And if you say that this is the way to heaven and no one comes to the Father except through Jesus, well, you're really kind of leaving some people out. Yep, that's exactly right. Because if it's true, if this is true, if Christianity's true, then the other things must be false. You know. And I find this interesting because anybody ever taken a test with true false questions? Yeah. And there's only one answer, isn't there? And if you get the wrong answer and you go up and tell the teacher, well, that's kind of you're you're being a little bit excluding me, you know, there. I'd like to be inclusive. I'd like to be part of this. I'd like to have a good grade. Well, put the right answer down, dude. Right? I mean, that's just the nature of truth. And I don't know what it is about our society, but here again, you go back to Pilate. And clearly they were discussing the same things then. It hasn't changed. Well, we could go on. Well, let me say this, though. Just like with the true and false test, you need to know why you marked the answer. And you remember when we did long division? I don't know if they do this anymore. I hope so. But in school, you had to show your work, right? You had to show your work. Why do you have to show your work? So that you know how you got the answer. And if there's a problem, then the teacher can look back here and say, whoop, right there, you made a mistake. Right? Same way with faith. We should be able to show our work. We should know why we believe what we believe, and we should be able to show our work. Okay? And that's really important, to be able to show your work. Okay, we'll talk about that a little more in a minute. Some people think that as long as you're sincere in what you believe, then that's all that's important. As long as you're sincere. But you can be sincerely wrong, can't you? Yeah. I have a lot of keys. There's keys on this ring to semis and box trucks and cars and houses. But I have to carry a lot because this key right here probably won't fit that door. And it doesn't matter how sincerely I believe it to be true. You know what I mean? I mean, I can believe that it's going to fit that door, and I can be sincere about it, and I can be really nice, but it ain't going to work. It's the nature of truth. It's the nature of truth. It doesn't matter how sincere you are, how much desire you have. Years ago, when I was young and stupid, now I'm just young and old and not too bright, but when I was young and stupid, I was bringing a Mack semi back from Ovid, and I was trying to get to the south side of Lansing. Is Don's Windmill truck stop still there on 69 and 27? It's not. Well, it was back in the old days. And we had an account there to buy fuel, and I was running low. And I knew I was running low. And all the way from Ovid to St. John's and down 27, I was praying like, Lord, you made the oil in the widow's barrel, you know, and it just kept a-coming and a-coming. I got 2 miles from the truck stop, right, was it 469 or something that runs around it, and what did I do? 1 o'clock in the morning, I ran out, because the truth of the matter was there wasn't enough fuel to make it, right? That was just the truth, and I had a lot of desire for it not to be true. I did. 1 o'clock in the morning, it's never fun. Desire doesn't have much to do with it. Doesn't have much to do with it. We should respect the rights of others to believe what they want to believe. We can't change them anyway. We need to respect them. But we might be foolish, even unloving, if we accept that all religious beliefs are true. Because if Christianity is true, this comes from the book, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. If Christianity is true, then it would be unloving to suggest to anyone that their opposing religious beliefs are true as well. It's unloving to let people assume that their untruth is true. Because if we affirm that error, then we really are encouraging them on the road to hell. Right? The next PowerPoint, I hope it's the next one. Yep. I preached last month from Romans 9 through 11. And that's where Paul talks about the Jewish question, the Jewish issue. And Freeman is Richard Freeman is a Messianic Jew, okay? A Messianic Jew is a Jew who believes in Jesus as the Messiah. Arguing that the Jews don't need Christ is practicing the worst type of anti-Semitism. Now think about that for a minute. What are some things that have been done to the Jews over the last few thousand years? Okay? Pretty rough. And even today, synagogues get burned. But think of Hitler. Some pretty tough things have happened to the Jews over the years, okay? Arguing that the Jews don't need Christ is practicing the worst type of anti-Semitism, as nothing can be more harmful to the Jews than withholding what? Everybody needs Jesus, right? Everybody. And to suggest that because you're the chosen people, or to suggest because you really believe what you believe really sincerely, or to suggest that, well, you've got some good things in what you believe, you know, and then to suggest that it's okay really is not a very loving thing to do. At least we need to be honest with people and share the truth. Truth matters. Jesus told Pilate, "For this reason I came into the world, to testify to the truth." And next PowerPoint. And what is the truth? Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and life. No one comes to who? The Father except through me." That's just the truth. And that's narrow. And that excludes. But that's truth. We need to be loving as we share truth. And we need to be not the high and mighty thing and whatever, but we need to share truth. We need to share truth. And it's helpful for me to know that Jesus encountered the same type of issues that we encounter today, even as he engaged the politician, Pilate, in a discussion, short discussion, but a discussion about truth. I want to be clear this morning that that we can know truth, and Jesus is truth. Jesus is truth. And no one comes to the Father except through him. And there is unanimous agreement in the body of Christ about that. Now, that doesn't mean that in the church you won't find people, Sunday school teachers and clergy, and a lot of people that don't believe it. But in the body of Christ, you have to have a way to take care of sin. And God's way to take care of sin was to send Jesus and take those sins on the cross. And if that's not a part of your truth, then it's not true. It's not Christianity. It's not. I'll respect you for believing what you want to believe, but it ain't, from my perspective, the way I understand truth, you ain't got it. Okay? What's the last PowerPoint? Or number six, not the last one. Sometimes people might not want to admit truth because that might convict them. That really could be a large part of it. But we're comfortable where we're at, And if we admit that this is truth, I might come under conviction. I might have to change. It's time for basketball. And basketball, through the years, the rules have changed. The rules are different in different countries. The rules are different for middle school and high school and college and pro. The rules are different. But if you see a basketball game, you can identify it, can't you? You can identify it. And it doesn't make any difference how sincerely you love football. If 11 guys show up in pads and a football to play the Detroit Pistons on a basketball court, and they say, oh, we don't know about basketball, we're going to play by football rules, and the Pistons say, well, we're going to play by basketball rules, there's going to be a problem, isn't there? We can identify basketball as opposed to football or opposed to soccer or tennis or whatever else. If you know basketball, but you got to know basketball. And you can know your truth, your Christianity. If you know the truth, then you don't have to know all the rules to everything else to be able to see it's not true. You know what I mean? If you know Christianity, then you can tell what's not Christian. You can tell, well, this is Islam. I don't know about your rules and your faith, but it ain't Christianity. Atheism, agnostic, secular humanism, whatever. You don't have to know all the rules. But if you know your rules to your game, then you can at least see that this ain't my game. Right? This isn't my... It's helpful to know some of these rules if you're going to witness to them, to kind of know where they're coming from. But the basics is, I got to know my game. I know my game. I know my truth. And I can identify what's not truth. Jesus is truth. Pilate didn't get it, but that didn't make Jesus wrong, did it? That didn't make Jesus wrong. People won't always get us either, but that doesn't make us wrong. May we be able to say with Paul, next PowerPoint. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, because it's the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. I think sometimes it's easy to get intimidated because we hear it all the time, this arrogant stuff and not being tolerant and whatever. Don't be ashamed of the gospel. And don't be ashamed of speaking truth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the words of Christ. We thank you, Father, that he had to deal with a lot of things we deal with. He had to deal with unbelief. Father, help us to be strong in our faith, not arrogant, not boastful. Help us to be respectful of others, even though they're wrong. Help us to be respectful. And most of all, help us to not only be able to speak, but to live a life where others would want to know what truth we live by. And help us be able to speak it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I got a little song here. It says, I was dead in my sins. Then Jesus came, because Jesus is truth, and he saved me. I'll sing this song for you, and then maybe if you want to join me on the chorus, you can. That's up to you. I was dead in my sins, just as if I had been buried and laid to rest. Then the one who overcame life and death called my name. He said, child, arise and be blessed. I was a dead man walking, but praise God I am alive, and I can't stop talking. died to testify, resurrected from the grave. From this darkness I've been saved. I was a dead man walking, but praise God I am alive. Just a shell of a man, until the master's hand reached down and lifted me from the depths of despair. He heard my prayer, and praise God, I'll live eternally. I was a dead man walking, but praise God, I am alive, and I can't stop talking. God to testify, resurrected from the grave. From this darkness I've been saved. I was a dead man walking, but praise God I am alive. Try it with me. Dead man walking, but praise God I am alive, and I can't stop talking. God to testify, resurrected from the grave. From this darkness I've been saved. I was a dead man walking, a dead man walking. I was a dead man walking, but praise God I am alive. You say amen to that?